Cool. So good morning, everyone. I underestimated Bombay traffic earlier, but it's all right. Like, we all are here on time. So cool. I am Pushpesh. I am a co-founder and CTO at Moonfrog. Some of you might have heard, some of you most probably have not heard who we are. So I'll go through that. But what I want to especially talk about here is our journey in the early stages of being a startup. Okay, some of you might be already be founders or working in a startup or might want to do a startup or might want to build a new product from scratch at some point in time, right? And we all run into this. We are building a consumer product. We want to understand how users are behaving, what's happening in the product, where are the drops, where are different users going, what features are working, not working. And then analytics or data platform, oh, we have been focusing on building the product or the application, but not the data analytics platform. So this is our journey, how we did it early on, like from the day one itself, because we knew that, okay, we have to build multiple products, so we will need data analytics again and again all the time on day one of the product launch. So these are few steps, few guidelines that we think that, okay, one should follow and generally keep in mind. Again, this is our journey. You can obviously take your own path, but these are just guidelines to share from our learnings and kind of mistakes that we made. So just to give a brief idea about who we are a mobile game gaming company, game development company, which makes mass market mobile games. So we aren't talking small size, we are saying mass market. Anybody who's out there, who's here, who's on the street, who's in the shops, who's driving cabs, who's working in a big corporate company, everyone is a player or is a potential target audience for us. Not just by making one product, by making a suite of multiple products and again. So you realize that, like, so we as a company have to make new products continuously at every interval, every cycle. So we need data from day one for this new product to figure out product market fit again. So this is very important to us. What's our current scale? We are approximately this is little old data, but we are approximately 6 to 7 million daily active users, daily active players, more than 15 million and more than 25 to 30 million monthly active users across all our games. On the right side, you can see that, okay, some of the games that we have made. This is not all the games, but these are some of the prominent ones. The top one, yeah, Teen Patti is famous in India, but we are one of the top ones there, and we are the top grossing across the board in India as a Teen Patti game, as a gaming company, as anything you can say. The other prominent games being one Alia Bhatt game we did the Bahubali official, like the big game, which is a real-time strategy game, okay, 20 MB real-time strategy game, like anything Clash of Clans, Clash of Kings, or all that kind of shape and size, made for India. Then we have, and at the bottom you can see a Ludo Club game, which is currently very, very popular on, especially not on the Google Play Store, but on the Facebook Messenger. So across all these games, we have more than 6 to 7 million daily active users. All these games, okay, at some point, and there are features, they are real-time games. Real-time, players are playing with each other in real-time on Indian network or Indian subcontinent networks. We have been doing this for 5 years. Obviously, now internet speeds have improved dramatically and will continue to improve, but it was not the case back in 2013. So we have been kind of doing this for India for quite some time. All the games are cross-platform games, optimized for our primary markets, which is India and the subcontinent. And as a company, we are profitable. So this is our journey, and in a short, I'll talk about the current scale in terms of data analytics that we do. We do approximately 20 billion events per day, unique events per day as of now. Total size of data that we ingest every day is more than 800 GB. So this is not small scale, like, okay, though the users are this, but for each user also we kind of capture tons of information continuously all the time. You're playing our game, anything you're doing, we kind of are tracking it in real time, as real time as possible. So obviously this is not where we started, but we knew that, okay, if we get to scale, we will see a lot of scaling requirements in analytics. So how did we go about it? Now just to kind of roll back 4 to 5 years, what we actually wanted on day one, like which were not negotiable. So we needed access to data of any product or game launches immediately. Like, you can't say that, okay, we'll launch the product and know about the data or how the product is doing next week or next month. No, that is a strict no-no for us. If we do not have data, we'll not launch the product. This was the rule to be followed from day one. Should be able to query row level. Like, in the beginning, like, okay, when you just launch the product, you have one user. You don't have 100,000 users. You have one user, two users, third user just came. So you need to know what's happening, what's that user's journey, what is he doing, what is he not doing, where is he dropping off, what is he not liking. So for that, you need to know each and every event that is getting fired by that user in that session as quickly as possible and as real time as possible. So we said in the beginning that, okay, less than 5 minute latency to the warehouse where we can query row level. So this is the requirement we put on day one. Second, cost sensitive. Cost sensitive in both terms, infrastructure, because obviously being a startup, bootstrapped startup, no money to start with, so obviously we'll use AWS free credits. So that was the first thumb rule. Second, ops light. Like, you can't spend, like, when you're busy building the product, you can't be spending your mind share and all this time cycles in fixing analytics ops, right? Third, resources. You don't have all the companies, all the products out there, and all startups for sure do not have unlimited resources, do not have resources to spare than to build analytics rather than building the main product, right? So in the beginning, we said we'll start with a shared engineering resource. Only that, we'll try to write down or kind of have our requirements very clearly and then increase it to one dedicated person after we start. That's it. Not 10 people, not 100 people, because you can't. This is reality. This is our journey. So not saying that it's good or bad, but this was what it was. And the third, large scale-up requirement. We knew that, okay, games, we had worked in games before. This was not our first foray. We had worked, me, my co-founders, my early people, like everyone worked at Zynga. Might have heard of it. Games like Mafia Wars, Farmville, Cityville, like really large scale games, like 30, 40 million daily active users kind of games. So we knew what scale means and what it would look like if it was a success. So we knew that, okay, we'll need to scale up at some point in time. But also we knew that, okay, we don't want to over-architect. So we said, should not cause headache till 1 million daily active users. So it's all right to plan for some future, but not necessarily for eternity. Now, so I've listed down 7 steps. Kind of I've made it as concise as possible. 7 steps which I feel we ended up following. Obviously, in hindsight, it's much easier. But take it as a guideline and see if it helps you in your journey of building a data pipeline for your products. First, understand. Understand your requirements. Understand your business constraints. Each business is little different from each other. Do not go by what's written in the blogs as like verbatim. Understand what is a must for your business and for the product or the product market fit to be figured out, and what is good to have and what is okay to delay for future. That is gonna be very different for you as a business and as a team as well. Who you are. If nobody is going to look up the data, then what's the point of just storing the data and capturing it for sake of it? And that's where, as an engineer, I feel that, okay, that's the difference between what you need, what you want, versus what is cool. And it's very important to differentiate early on because you don't have resources. So that's what is very important. I'll go in details. Second, think generic. This is more from our perspective. Obviously, if you're building one product, you don't need to necessarily think generic to its definition. But we had to support multiple games. We knew that, okay, this is the first game. We'll make another game in next quarter. We'll have to make 4 games in next year. So we knew that, okay, we have to rinse and repeat the same analytics platform or the data pipeline. So we had to think generic. I'll give examples on how did we go about it, which is a lightweight way of looking at generic data schema. Third, produce data well. If you do not have very foolproof, very clean system of data production, your whole pipeline is not going to be much useful. Like, okay, a lot of ML, lot of data analysis that you are going to do or your team is going to do later on, if your data is noisy or has corrupt data or corrupt things coming in, then it will be more headache for you later on. So keep it clean, keep it simple, and produce it well. Fourth, design V1.0 of your data pipeline. Do not design for eternity. Design V1.0. I'll talk about, okay, how we did it in the sense where to cut corners, where not to, and how did it pan out for us. Fifth, open up, enable many data interfaces. once we have captured the data, it's very important to open the whole, whatever you have captured, as quickly as possible to your team. If you're not using the data and you have just captured it, it's useless. So know how to use it in your product for the benefit of the product, benefit of your business, benefit of your tech, whatever it is, but open up. Then sixth, obviously tune and repeat. But specifically, I will talk about like, optimize for usage, not necessarily for just, oh, this is a new tool available in the market or somebody saying that, okay, this is better. Optimize for own usage because you have certain people, you have certain business requirements. Fix for that first and then go to the next step. Seventh, upgrade to V2.0. After that, after you know that, okay, you are capturing data well, you are storing it well or ingesting it well or all that stuff, and you are using it well. Before that, do not try to upgrade to a new system, no matter what. And especially this is important because games do not give you warning before they scale up. They can, if someone tweets about it, they will go to the next level immediately. Like, okay, in a matter of a day, I have seen games go to 1 million to 5 million daily active users. So games do not give you warning. So I think that, okay, we have an example where it's all right to think in this framework. Still with the market going or market forces acting on their own will, you can still catch up and kind of do the right thing. So let's go deeper. Like the first, understand requirements and constraints. This is example of what our business requirements and constraints were. I've listed it down. You can obviously look at your own products. Divided into three columns, primarily business, tech and ops. We knew that we are a tech company. But we have a real business, which we want to. We did not want to just make games for the games as a product part of it. Games as a business is what we do. So we listed down first the business requirements or constraints that real-time ingestion is important. What we mean by real-time is not necessarily to the engineering definition of real-time. What we mean a business definition of real-time. Like, oh, user clicked a button. I need to know about it in some time. Not 1 hour later, not a day later, but in some time, but doesn't have to be the microsecond or a millisecond. So know that, okay, what is the real-time definition for your business is and stick to that. Second, fast query speeds. Since we did not have dedicated teams and other things, like, okay, so we have to in the beginning worry about, okay, how can we get access to, can I run the query and get the result rather than submit the query and get the result in an email or in a notification, I think, no. I want to run the query. Then who will be running the query? Your founder will be running the query or you will be running the query, the developer or the QA or the product manager or all these people who are actually a one resource at the end of the day. So you need to run the query and get the result immediately rather than submit the query and see it later. Third, SQL query interface. Again, this is our choice. We came from a gaming company. We were already using something. We knew that, okay, whoever we are going to work with, they all will know SQL. And that's it. So let's stick to that. So SQL was very important. We put it in the constraint upfront. Like, let's not kid around here. We don't have time here. So let's put SQL as an important query interface. Good that, okay, we know that, okay, all product managers have been engineers or generally have exposure to SQL. Very easy to learn SQL, all resources. Your engineers know SQL. Your QA can also potentially. So anyone in the company can potentially learn SQL very quickly and write queries. Fourth, row level granularity, need to know what each user is doing. And fifth point in the business requirements, rich events. Cannot have some other team to kind of figure out how to join. Oh, this event I have, but I don't know what this user's metadata is about. So try to make the event as rich as possible so that the event itself has some contextual information. I'll go through the example and you will see what we mean by rich. So that one person, whoever that person is, can kind of answer a question, whatever business question is, or get the answer to that as quickly as possible alone, without requiring an army of people. Going to tech constraints or requirements, we wanted generic data design because we knew that, okay, we have to rinse and repeat. New games, again, we have to use it. So we wanted generic data design. Forward and backward compatibility. Games as products, you are releasing more or less every day. And we are in business 5 years, and I do not know of a week where we have done less than 3 releases on one game. So we are doing releases continuously. So we have to be forward and backward compatibility, cannot break the whole data pipeline. Third, simple architecture. because it will be simpler to manage and less resource intensive. Fourth, immutable data that we put it as constraint will, once written, will not change it, whatever the event is. And I'll go through like how that has impacted our design. Ops, that's also equally important. When we say that, okay, we are a data first company, we need analytics on day one. If you cannot keep the uptime 24/7, then you're not really a data company then. So hosted services, we have to use hosted services. We don't have bandwidth, we don't have DevOps and SRE and all that stuff. Scale out capability we'll require from day one. And resilience to bad queries, this is very important. And this is kind of due to the choices we have made. We said that okay, anyone can access data in the company. That means that again, most probably half of them or most of them will write inefficient queries. So it's all right. We will handle it. We will take care of it. So that is a design, how that matters in the design. At the bottom, I've given example of the kind of questions we ask in the business to give you a flavor of it. So like, okay, one question is this. How many users who played at least one game yesterday? Very simple question anyone asks. We are saying we ask even more complicated. How many users who played at least one game yesterday saw the bonus pop-up also? Even more complicated, how many users who played at least one game yesterday saw the bonus pop-up for the first time? And this is not a complicated question for a business to ask. This is very simple. Like, okay, while walking, we'll ask this. Okay, yesterday we added this pop-up. How many people saw it for the first time? And we have to answer it. We have to convert this question into a SQL query as quickly as possible. So your schema has to back it up. And then this is not where the business question ends. This is just a kind of at the opening of the rabbit hole. Then the next question, oh, how does it compare to the last week? What happened yesterday? How, what happened with bonus pop-up? This is the trend. What is, what about the other pop-up that we added last week? So it goes into that. So your whole data pipeline has to support that kind of questioning. Otherwise, you will hinder the questioning part from the product side itself, which again, I think will show up in your speed at the end of the day, but just to give you flavor of what we do. So this is high level of like three different buckets where all these requirements and constraints matter. First, data design. Like data design should support multiple features and games. So generic data model required, and changes to schema often required in the beginning. Reality, this is all right. Interface and usage should have SQL interface, SQL, ease of use for the teams, and resistant to error in queries as well as inefficient usage. So people will write bad queries and it will be inefficient. They will do extra joins and inefficient filters. It's okay. We have to make it work. Third, scale, have a scalable system. Scale up and down because the games do go up and down like this in terms of daily traffic. I'll show you a graph at the end. And scale out easily because you have, will see scale in terms of number of users, also the ceiling going up. So how do you scale it out? Now let's go to the point number two, which is think generic. On the right side in the box, what I have written is some high level guidelines, like okay, in terms of keywords that I would want to put. If you don't remember anything, it will be good if you just try to remember some of that. First rule was generic. Data schema has to be generic. That was our requirement. Like that's rule. Look, nobody is trying to ask question why it has to be generic. No, it has to be generic. We'll add more columns as we go along. It's okay. We said we will add. That's the reality. So how do we support it? Third, normalization. How much normalization and how much not? We all go through that whenever we are doing schema design. So we do have some normalization requirement, but then also not getting to full definition of all CNF forms to be hit. Somewhere, stop somewhere in the middle, knowing your business requirements. So this is the example. This is again a subset of tables. I'll give an example. So these are some of the tables, say, we created, we have created. Like first is a table count, M table count, the Moonfrog table count, is for all generic events in the game, like which in Google Analytics or Flurry, you will have the normal, whatever the table is. Every event comes there as a dump. Second is M table economy. Like games, if you have played, you know that there is virtual currency, right? Currency is coming in the game, going out of the game, users are gaining from bonuses and other things, buying it and then spending it and other things. As game as a business, that's the most important thing that we have to worry about. Like if any, like okay, more than the game itself, the economy is important. Because if there is no economy, you are not making any money. So economy gets its own table to be managed. M table user for all user specific event and user metadata. M table open for all app open events. Sometimes when we're doing app development, you know that, okay, half the time people have opened the app and kind of tech problems and then dropped off or something of that sort. So that doesn't require user data necessarily. We just need to know how many people opened and the loading screen loaded or did not load. So that's a sometimes becomes little more aggregate level analysis. So we created separate and payment. Payment, obviously, we all know why it's important. Now, why this table helps us do certain things. So this is like, okay, if you just join M table count and M table user, it helps you kind of do answer some of the questions like this. How many users opened bonus pop-up? How many users from Rajasthan played poker and Rummy both yesterday? So these kind of questions, like, okay, you can just do joins. Now, each question, the person who's writing the SQL is now thinking which two tables I can join. And I just have to write that, and it's okay. And it'll work, like, okay. So very basic, and it works. It works for every single person. Engineers can do it very easily, but it works for every single person in the company from practical experience, I'm telling. Then, like, you can merge any two tables, like user and payment. How many users made successful transactions in last 5 minutes? Fair enough. How many unique users on iOS faced transaction failures yesterday? That also can be done by doing this. And since it is joined by user, the subsequent question you can ask, I need to know which user exactly, so that I can pull up the whole session information, like every single event that he fired in that particular session, to retrace his steps, his or her steps, to know where the problem was or what exactly happened. So this helps us kind of ask subsequent question very fast and answer it. You don't need to kind of run this query somewhere and then submit the result to a central team saying that, okay, find out more about it. No, you can find out yourself. Now, going a little deeper, example-wise, M table count. What we did is very interesting, and I don't know if you guys have seen this anywhere, but this is what worked beautifully for us. This is a sample of what it looked like early on in early days of what the table was. This is the schema. So counter, count, kingdom, phylum, class, family, genus. This is specifically very important. Nomenclature-wise, we all have seen this somewhere. We all have studied in school. This works is, like, we have seen Google Analytics. It gives us 2-3 levels. Maybe some other tools gives us 3 levels. We wanted more. And why did we want more? I'll give it to you an example. But we came up with, okay, it has nothing to do with the game that we are building. For no matter which game, for what feature, for what part of the feature, you can track it in this way. The whole biological system has been divided into this. Every single animal, tree, to any living being fits into this kind of nomenclature. So why can't our data fit it? So this is a very interesting way of nomenclature-wise. And trust me, it has become first level. Like, okay, it's no longer new joinees in the company are asking, like, okay, what is kingdom exactly? Why did you name? No, it is not common. Like, nobody is, like, okay, having a kind of a special moment. Like, hold on, what is kingdom? What's the difference between phylum? Frankly, the usage of data doesn't have to care about what is kingdom and phylum. And frankly, the data analytics doesn't have to care what is inside phylum and class and genus and etc. The context is up to you. Data pipeline doesn't care about context, it cares about the structure, and that's it. So data is structured for the sake of tech, but at the same time, it is unstructured. The context is up to you, the way you want to use it. Now, this is the example. So example one, like we say, start session is the counter. So whoever is the product manager or the responsible guy for that part of the business looks up to that. Kingdom can be like player load. It's up to them to define. Context is theirs. They can say player load or player load not, whatever they want to name it. It's up to them. We just say it has to be varchar of 50 characters max. Now whatever they want to put. Player load started, where it started, loading screen, which button did he click, button 120. Genus, empty, I don't want to use it, it's okay. Which is the player ID? Okay, here's the player ID. What is the client timestamp or the timestamp on the server side when we saw it? So there can be differences and other things, fair enough to capture. OS, which OS was he playing? We say Gplay, Google Play, iOS, web, whatever it is. Game ID, which game are we talking about? So these are the generic parts for data pipeline. So when the data engineer is looking at it, he's just looking all kingdoms are coming fine or not, all phylums are coming fine or not. Not looking at, okay, the player load is coming fine or not. No, we just look at kingdom is coming fine or not. The same game for some other event will look like start session, player load, player load started, now player load finished. Now what kind of questions you can ask by just by this, these two events? How many users tried to player load? You can ask, just group by kingdom. How many start session have fired a started event but not finished? That also you can. How many times users successfully loaded by clicking on button 120? Because you will change buttons, right? You will add more buttons, remove more buttons and other things. This also you can do. So it helps you do all this stuff, and data engineer, data pipeline guy doesn't have to come into question. He doesn't know what is inside the kingdom, and it's all right. So that was example. Now come to data production part. Produce data very well. If you don't produce properly from all different sources, it will bite you tomorrow, and it will doesn't help with the next levels. Some thumb rules that we followed. Keep your data producer dumb. Keep them dumb. Do not put brains on that side, because then it will be very hard to monitor them, change them, fix them, where the errors are happening. Keep it very simple, very clean, very dumb. Less transformations. That's a rule we followed. We allowed data to insert the way we want to consume, as simply as that. And the data structure that we talked about helped us do that. Enrich the data. Now you saw like a kingdom, phylum, class, genus, family, genus. 5 levels. So add more context. The row itself will make sense to the right person by itself. You don't have to, oh, what is this saying? I do not know. Like, okay, that itself has enough information, and misuse is okay. It's okay. People will do a typo, player load, they wrote something else. It's okay. Why do you care? As a data engineer, you should not care. It's okay. Like, let them fix the context themselves rather than taking, kind of doing a very tight linking between these two. We kind of remove the link completely. So what we did here, identified all the data producers and understand the requirements accordingly. In our case, we obviously have Android, iOS, and all these apps. So they have to generate data. Users are clicking directly there. So we actually, in one of the games, we captured for small time, captured every single swipe that they do. Because we were trying to figure out where they are dropping off, why they are not getting this right swipe action. In games, it's important, right? So we enabled that also on the fly, and it's okay. So some constraints which come into reality, cannot keep sending each event over network. So we solved it by batching, seems like. Cannot lose data even if app is app crashes or is killed by the user and other things. We would want to capture as much as possible. 100% is not possible, but still as much as possible, so that we know that, okay, why did he uninstall or why did he drop off in the pod. So use local disk storage and back it up and other things. Keep out of context from the application itself. Know that, okay, when I said we do 3 releases a week on average for last 5 years, in some of the weeks we are doing multiple releases on the day. So your code is under flux at a tremendous pace. So your data pipeline cannot come into that fire. So it has to be separate enough, but at the same time, not breakable just like that. So try to develop it as a library. It's okay. Like, okay, keep it generic, things. Second part of our stack is lot of microservices, which most of you must be also having. So lot of microservices mean lot of data producers. They will scale at their own will. That team will decide what to do, whether it's a monolith or whether it is a full-on microservice, whether they are horizontally scaling, vertically scaling, whatever they're doing. So your data production part also has to scale accordingly with it. Cannot keep sending each event over network. Your microservices cannot be sending so much over the internal LAN itself that, okay, that becomes starts to become a bottleneck at some point. So again, batching, use local disks on the boxes, try to see how you can do a network sync easily. Keep data collection agnostic of microservice itself. You don't know how many microservices that particular team is gonna write. So today they have 3, tomorrow they will have 30, and this is a reality. They will have. So develop it again as a library. You should not care which microservice is calling or sending you data. Why do you care? Data is the first level citizen, data as it is. Whoever wants to send, send us like this, send us like this. I'm not going to make an exception. I'm not going to accept any other this thing also. So those requirements, batching, using local disk, and standardized common libraries, this became a requirement to write the data production layer, which is the SDK or those. You might have your own microservice to capture data, so all that stuff. Example I've given, like, okay, you will see that, okay, there are three examples I've given, like count sample, visit. And they all take similar parameters, counter, count, kingdom, phylum, class, family, genus, exactly like the data structure was, how it's going to be in the table. So direct mapping, like, okay, there is not much data transformation is happening, and for a reason. And also, all these functions are just wrappers. They are just abstractions. So you have given that abstracted layer to the application developer so that they can do the right thing, but your data structure remains the same. You are ingesting everything in the same format. So you are just given different interfaces, and that's it. Sample usage being stats controller count. So start session, player, load, finish, canceled. Something like the example we talked about. Now the fourth step, which is design V1.2. Very, very important. The V1.2 is the most important part. Now, this is an image of not what we did. This is a very typical data pipeline architecture, data sources, then your integration layer, ETL, goes to data lake, then to data warehouse, and then dashboards, reporting, BI engine uses it. Very standard. Obviously, you don't have resources, you don't have time, and how do you build it? So first, we defined the guidelines. Less layers. This has too many layers for us to handle practically in the beginning. We don't have time and resources. Keep it transparent. Keep it transparent and okay, what you get is what you ingest. The rule for the data pipeline engineer. You ingested player load, so you will get player load. Okay, okay, I do not care. So nobody, product managers cannot come to a data engineer and say that, okay, I ingested player load, but I can't find it. Or I put buy pop-up in the kingdom, but I can't find it. So data engineer has to be agnostic of that. You entered in the kingdom, right? So it should be in the kingdom. I don't even have to look it up. I have not done any transformation, so it will not go anywhere. So that's it. Did you put it in kingdom? Did you search in the kingdom? That's it. So it helps. And it's only V1. Most important, know that it will change. You will change it yourself. More requirements will come. You should make it harder, or you should make it little, like, okay, the enough questions should be asked, but still it will change, so it's okay. So this is what we started with, high level. We kind of merged the data ingestion or the ETL layer to the left side, which is the data sources itself. So microservices, whatever it is, everyone gets a SDK or a client to send data. We have given it to the library. You send us data using this. This will directly ingest to our data warehouse, not to data lake. Why? Because we needed to query immediately. So if a row has been ingested, there is an end user here lying around, like, okay, can I query that? Can I do a join? Can I do a select count star, whatever? So we had to insert in data warehouse first, and then in parallel do it to the data lake and sync it to the data lake. So data lake became our secondaries. In multiple discussions with a lot of AWS and data folks around Bangalore and other things, I've realized that, okay, this is an anti-pattern. Like, okay, we are going data warehouse to data lake rather than data lake to warehouse. It helps the use case. If your whole kind of data consumers or users can wait, are fine submitting a query and coming back after 1 hour to look at the results, it's okay. Maybe the pattern works fine. But for us, that's not the case, so we had to choose this anti-pattern. And then users are directly querying the warehouse, and the dashboards, reporting, BI tools, engines, and other things are also querying data warehouse. So it helps. This is the first cut, obviously. This helped us do the early things on the products. We launched a product, we knew immediately users are dropping or did not drop. How did the install funnel look like? User installed the app, what did he do in the first minute? For games, like the most important question. We like, okay, kind of kill each other over this. That, okay, what did he do? Tell me what did he do in the first session, first minute, 30 seconds, what did he do? If we don't know, we are blind. Then we are screwed. It's not, games are not transactional platforms. You don't know that, oh, he wanted to buy a shoe, so he bought a shoe. No. Users don't know what they want to do. So they clicked because Shah Rukh Khan's picture was there. Now it didn't turn out to be that. So we have to know that. We have to know their favorite color before they do. And that's important. Some details of this, you might have seen a squirrel kind of thing. So that's the name we gave. This is our internal client. So just some details about that. It was a data collector, but a thick client, not thin, because we merged the whole data integration in ETL to it. written in Golang. We knew that it has to be performant to some extent. Deployed homogeneously. We don't care which microservice, where you want to deploy it. Here, game team, take it, deploy wherever you want. Rotate and move file in a local folder. Processes events only once, guarantee. Only once, and for sure. Input interface was a file, which is being written locally by the SDK. And batch reading, file rotating, archiving, cleanup so that the disks are cleaned up. Output interface directly to Redshift and S3. Redshift being our data warehouse that we chose in the beginning. Again, free credits. Worked. SQL interface in the beginning works very beautifully. Obviously, we didn't have to pay in the beginning, so it was a good decision in that sense. Batch writes to Redshift and S3 because you're doing a network call. S3 APIs versus Redshift APIs, which one works at what pace you should do it, and then accordingly tune the batch. I'll come to that in the tuning part a little bit. Redshift started with DC2 large, whoever knows. The smallest node, two core, I think, and then 15 GB RAM. We started with that because we thought that's enough, but since it can scale horizontally, it was okay to start with. Different users and queues for ingestion and usage know that, okay, it's all going at one place. So your compute is going to happen. So compute should not starve ingestion, and ingestion should not starve your compute. So have different queues. Keep moving window of data. Started with 120 days. So we started with 120 day retention so that disk is limited, and daily unloads for that. Fifth step, open up many data interfaces. Keep it simple, transparent. Misuse is okay, again, from behind. And use third-party interfaces. So we directly give access using DB Visualizer and SQL Workbench, do whatever. Several tools, Metabase, Redash. Daily business reports through JDBC or DBC scripts and other things. We did a hack. We use Datadog as our charting library. We sent data to that in 15 minutes, 5 minutes intervals, and use their charting. That's a hack. As a startup, obviously, you can't build the whole UI upfront. So dashboarding, alerting, we use them. Some few things we also had to do, but we don't have time. We can talk about it later. Like, since we had less data, we had to load data back if somebody wants it. They want it rarely. Once in a week, they would want older data. So we just enabled that using Rundeck scripts. Now tune and repeat. Know that not all data is important. Always backup at all levels. Drop and rebuild quick. Any issue, drop the data from your warehouse immediately and rebuild it quickly. Have that capability. If you can do that, it enables you to do a lot more. And data will increase with time. Not just in terms of number of rows, but also in terms of columns. And the columns will also increase in complexity. So Redshift, you have to enable compression on certain things. And when to do, when not to do also comes in picture. So bottlenecks in ingestion, we had to worry about it. Insert versus copy in Redshift. Parallelization requirement. Thick client leading to problems as the application itself scaled up. Bottlenecks due to usage. We realized we needed more columns as we went along, your data scientist or product manager. Cool equation of queries. User asks one query, then another, then another, then another. Like 10 queries continuously to answer the business question. That means that, okay, if the table is big and you are looking at only subset of data, it becomes an issue. So we had to introduce split tables on the bigger tables, like M table count was split into count pop-up, count button, and other things to kind of give a faster query speeds. Now, then comes the last step. This is how it looks like roughly V2.0. Left side, like this side is all the applications, different kind of applications from mobile clients to your web services, microservices, some 20 of them now. They all send data to what we call Badger pipeline. That's our new system. Centralized kind of controls written in Golang, NSQ, if anybody has used for distributed queuing, works beautifully over there for us. Very small footprint, but handles our current scale. Again, data lake, anti-pattern we have still hold on to. We are pushing data warehouse directly, Redshift is still. But we added a real-time layer also, which is powered by MemSQL, so that the SQL interface is maintained, but at the same time, we are able to kind of have some data much faster than otherwise. And we have added over time priority queues and other things for different data, different priorities, and different SLAs and other things. I'm not covering that here, but high level. Now we have moved from thick client to thin client, which we called Badger. Does more or less same thing, but doesn't upload to the network. Just sends data over TCP to NSQ, and that's it. So that becomes faster, very lightweight, works beautifully for us. And again, keep them dumb, less transformation, misuse is okay, and centralize for performance. Not centralize just for the sake of it. Centralize only when the performance becomes a bottleneck for you. And current scale, total events per day, 20 billion plus. This is unique, not counting some of the redundancy. Total size of the data, 800 GB plus. Average events per second, 200,000. Peak event per second, this is the bottom graph you can see in before, like, okay, dinner, after dinner, games do see high traffic, especially when everyone is sleeping, it will be low. So peak events go up to 350,000. And even at the lowest point, it is around 65 to 70,000. So it's never zero, but at the same time. So our infrastructure has to scale up and down accordingly and also be ready for higher scales. So this is what it looks like. And I think this journey has helped us get there. Build it incrementally, not worry about that big bang aha moment, but kind of knowing the business, knowing it inside out, knowing the usage. And I think the most important thing I'll emphasize is collect well, but at the same time, make sure you are actually going to use the data and you are using it. Make sure data is the first level citizen in your company, in your product. Otherwise, all this is just a good tech problem to solve, not a business problem, or not going to help the company or the product much. So just a recap, these are the steps. Happy to talk about it if anybody wants to go deeper into one of the specific things and other things. Cool. Thank you.